Welcome to episode 671 of the podcast devoted to the classic and sometimes not so classic genre cinema of yesteryear. This is Monster Kid Radio. My name is Derek M. Cook, and the music you're hearing right now is a little song called Catacomber. Catacomber is from the band The Ouija Chords. It's from their release Rot and Roll with The Ouija Chords. You can find them at theouijachords.bandcamp.com. They gave us permission to play their music here on the show. You'll hear the song in its entirety at the end of this episode. In fact, when I reached out to them, they responded by saying, "Hey, thanks for getting in touch. I'm actually somewhat familiar with Monster Kid Radio. Stoked that you like our music. P.S. Loved your episode on Freaks." Well, hey, I appreciate that. That means a lot that you went and checked out some episodes of Monster Kid Radio and you liked the episode on Freaks. That was a fun episode to do, and an important one to do, I feel like, with Steve Turek. And man, I love your music. So listeners, go check out what they are up to at theouijachords.bandcamp.com. They are a surf band based out of New Mexico. They've got a handful of releases available on Bandcamp, and Monster Kid Radio approves. What's going on this week? Well, I got a couple of things in the chamber lined up. So first of all, instead of Mark Matsky's beta capsule review this week, he actually called in a voicemail when he came back from G-Fest, the big Godzilla convention and kaiju convention that happens once a year. I've never been to it myself, but one of these years I'm going to get out there. In the meantime, I have to live vicariously through people like Mark, who did call in and let us know something Ultraman-related that he learned at G-Fest. So we're going to be playing that, and then we've got Kenny's look at Famous Monsters of Filmland, of course, a staple here on Monster Kid Radio. The bulk of the episode, though, this is good. This is really good. While I'm waiting for some of the audio to come in that was collected at Monster Bash by some of our dedicated listeners, Scott and Tracy Morris already hooked me up with one recording that they took, and this was the presentation given by Victoria Price. Victoria Price is not a stranger to Monster Bash. She's not a stranger to us here on Monster Kid Radio. I've had the pleasure, the absolute honor, to have met her multiple times over the years at multiple events, and she is amazing. And she was at Monster Bash this past summer, and she gave a presentation. Now, I am excited to share that with you here. When she gave the presentation, there were accompanying slides. So there's a few times during the talk that she refers to something that you might be seeing on screen. That said, she then goes on to describe what you're seeing on screen. So even though this is an audio podcast and you don't see the pictures that she's showing, she's describing them well enough that, well, you can keep up. It's a great talk that she gives. I've heard portions of this or versions of this in the past at various events. And, you know, I'm going to be completely honest with you. There are parts of this conversation that I needed to hear right now in my life because I'm struggling with a couple of things on a personal level. And just hearing some of the things that Victoria Price is sharing, it's inspiring, it's moving. It's monstrously fun, and I have to give a huge shout out to Scott and Tracy Morris from Disney Indiana for capturing this audio, and to Monster Bash for allowing us to play Monster Bash material here on the show. Scott and Tracy Morris, I mentioned Disney Indiana, that is their home podcast, and they've been going for quite some time now. They have, as of this recording, 421 episodes available for you to download over at DisneyIndiana.com. They don't just talk about Disney movies. They talk about everything Disney related. Marvel films, Pixar movies, the Muppets, the theme parks. It's a good show. The production is top notch. The material is even better. I highly recommend it. And again, Monster Kid Radio approves. Make sure you go over to DisneyIndiana.com and give them a listen and let them know that Monster Kid Radio sent you. Okay, let's go ahead and get on with this episode of Monster Kid Radio right now.
One second ago, it was human. Now the most monstrous creation of all, the return of the fly. Human beings are his guinea pigs as once again man challenges the supreme power of the universe, then tries to hide from the world the monsters he has created. What is the terrible secret of his father's death, and how can he keep the world from knowing he is the son of the fly? The world cries out in terror at the return of the fly. You will also see the terrifying tale of a wedding night that turned into a nightmare. She married one of the alligator people. See it happen before your eyes. See the thing that will make your skin crawl. Don't miss The Alligator People and The Return of the Fly.
This is Vincent Price. I've been involved in many blood-chilling films like The House of Wax and The Fly, but never have I played in a more terrifying shocker than my new picture, The House on Haunted Hill. It's a story guaranteed to make you shudder with fright. See The House on Haunted Hill, if you dare.
Hi, Derek. It is Mark, your ultra pal, the producer of the Monster Kid Radio Beta Capsule Review, and I'm just freshly home from G-Fest number 29. I just wanted to quickly say that we learned some exciting things at G-Fest this year. Ultraman and Tsuburaya Productions had a really strong presence at the conference. And a couple of things that they let us know is that there's going to be a new young adult book line coming out entitled Ultra Academy, which sounds like a lot of fun. And one of the coolest things about that is that Tsuburaya has been very open and sharing of their property. They're going to be able to use the original Science Patrol insignia on all of the book covers, and this is really kind of an exciting partnership as Ultraman continues to make his way into the North American audience. Also, they announced that they will be continuing to work with Mill Creek in producing physical media, so that was also cool to hear. The other reason that I called is that I wanted to just compliment you and Beth on the Shin Godzilla episode that recently came out. It is one of the most intelligent discussions of that movie that I've heard in a long time, if ever. And so thank you for that entire conversation, capturing that, recording it, and sharing it with us. It really is a great film. I happen to be a huge fan of it in all of its permutations. I like the subtitled version. I even like the dubbed version. I'll go back and forth between the two. Just a really great vision of Godzilla, maybe his scariest incarnation that we have on film so far. Although Minus One gives Shin a run for his money. That would be an interesting battle, would it not? All right, that's it. And hope this continues to be a tradition, perhaps, of some more call-ins. Thanks.
Mark, thanks for the information about G-Fest. Beth is not here right now. I'll talk a little bit more about that at the end of the show, but I will share your kind thoughts with her when I speak with her next, which will be, well, as of this moment, as I'm recording this, probably in about 10, 15 minutes. So I'll share that with her. And thanks for the information about Ultraman. More Ultraman in the world is always ultra good by me, even if my bank account and wallet do not agree. I've actually had to slow down on the Mill Creek releases. I used to buy them as soon as they became available, but I've had to slow down here. Just financially, it didn't make sense. And now I'm in the process of packing things up for a big move. And well, the more DVDs I have, the more I have to figure out how to get them from one place to another. So I'm really glad to hear that Mill Creek and Tsuburaya Productions' relationship is going to continue, because it means these things will hopefully stay in print long enough for me to get caught back up eventually. And a young adult book series? That just sounds awesome. I'm totally down for that. You know, speaking of Ultraman, I was actually talking with my stepdaughter, Jin, last night about anime, and I never gave the Ultraman anime series a shot. I know you can watch it on Netflix. Listeners, and Mark in particular, is it worth checking out? I know that I've said repeatedly that when it comes to kaiju material, I like to see it live action. I like to see it on the screen. You know, the comic books don't do as much for me. They're fun, but just something about seeing models break, you know, knowing that it existed in real life, even if Shin Godzilla or Godzilla Minus One is more CG. It's just something cooler about it in live action. I don't know if I'd have that same disconnect if I watched an animated version of Ultraman. So should I give it a watch? Oh, who am I kidding? You know I'm going to watch it. But I'd be curious to hear what you think, Mark, as well as anybody else out there. Have you watched the Ultraman animated series, and what do you think of it? Beth, why don't you let them know how they can send in their thoughts on that?
Have something you'd like to share with Monster Kid Radio? You can email the podcast at monsterkidradio@gmail.com, or you can call and leave a voicemail at 360-524-2484.
Edgar Allan Poe's Tomb of Ligeia. Poe considered it his masterpiece.
She will not die because she willed not to die.
Vincent Price, magnificent, macabre, defying the deathless, jealous spirit of Ligeia. A nightmare of terror. Pitting their lust for life against the unholy powers of the undead. The undead attack the living. A wondrous world of maddening horror. Starring Vincent Price in Edgar Allan Poe's Tomb of Ligeia in color.
The House of Wax, the ultimate dimension in terror, comes to the screen in StereoVision 3D. Vincent Price at his diabolical best will take you room by terrible room on a journey to the ultimate chamber of horrors. StereoVision 3D will synthesize before your eyes the terrifying reality of it all. In StereoVision 3D, House of Wax is more than a movie. It's an experience you'll never forget.
Hello there, Monster Kid Radio heads. This is Kenny with a look at famous monsters of Filmland. Today, we are hearing some highlights from the 2024 Summer Monster Bash. I found an article on FM 107 from May of 1974 about a bash-style film festival Uncleforia attended. In this segment, we will take a look at the intro and the guest list. Famous Monsters for April 1973 promised its readers, "Next year, you'll read about it here, the second science fiction and fantasy film convention." Well, next year is here. The Film Con is exciting past history. And for the benefit of you Film Monster fans who missed it, or those of you who would like to relive it, here are the highlights as promised. Rubbing Elbows with the Stars. Imagine Luncheon with Exeter, Jeff Morrow of This Island Earth. Munchin' with Robert Psycho Block. Seeing a Superman serial and then listening to the star, Kirk Allen, in person. Asking Pamela Franklin for her autograph while telling her how much you liked her in The Innocents, Necromance, and The Legend of Hell House. Posing for a picture with always smiling, always obliging John Agar of Mole People, Tarantula, Journey to the Seventh Planet, etc. Discussing the book that was the basis of The Night Stalker with its author, Jeff Rice, or his remarkable role as the vampire with its very nice star, Barry Atwater. And more. Many more. Celebrities like Robert, Count Yorga, Quarry, Dr. Donald, Dracula Society leader, Reed, Richard Duell Matheson, William Blackula, Marshall, George Clayton Johnson, Logan's Run collaborator, Bob, Time for Beanie, Clampett, Star Trek folk like writer DC Fontana and Tribble maker David Gerald, and popular player George Takei, Rick Baker, Monster Maker, John Schlock Landis, Jim A1 Animator Danforth, Don the Frankenstein Legend Glute, William Seven Faces of Dr. Lao Tuttle, Harvey Necromancy Jason, and, as Ed Sullivan would say, a pair of really big ones, Robert Wise, who has given us such great ones as The Day the Earth Stood Still, The Haunting and The Andromeda Strain, and Roger Corman, Guest of Honor. 10-year-old Kenny would have loved to be there. Next time we have Monster Bash coverage, we will hear part 2, Forey's opening address. That is all for this week's look at Famous Monsters of Filmland. We will have more next time. For MKR, this is Kenny saying adios.
This is the sound of a human heartbeat. But this heartbeat is different because this heart is beating outside the body. Vincent Price saw to that. Vincent Price has long been a master of mayhem, but in Theater of Blood, he outdoes himself at doing people in. Theater of Blood, from United Artists, rated R, under 17, not admitted without a parent.
Flesh crawls. Blood curdles. The coffin hasn't been built that can hold him. Dr. Fives rises again.
Fives! Wait!
Dr. Fives rises again in an even more startling motion picture with a whole new gallery of gruesome gimmicks of torture and murder. See the scorpion's embrace. The eagle's caress.
No, no!
The sausage machine. See Dr. Fives outduel his enemies with the most diabolical devices ever created. See Dr. Fives rises again, starring Vincent Price as the menacing Fives and Robert Quarry as the evil Beiderbecke. Dr. Fives rises again. All new from American International Pictures. Rated PG, parental guidance suggested. Dr. Fives rises again.
So some of you have heard me talk before, and those of you who haven't, I think, you know, I take a little bit of an unconventional approach. I'll tell you why I take the unconventional approach. My dad had a 65-year career. My stepmother had an even longer career. And my mother, she was an actress named Coral Brown. She was the one he fried under the hairdryer in Theater of Blood. And my mother was a costume designer, and she had an equally long career. And they were creative, fascinating people who believed in the importance of a creative life. I got to about 49 years old, and I realized that I had only learned half the lesson I needed to learn from my parents. I, too, was really focused on having this creative, full life, but I had taken it to the point of becoming a workaholic. And the next year, it was my dad's 100th birthday, and I was invited to go out and talk about my dad, and I was really feeling like I'm about to turn 50 and all I've done is just work my butt off. And I feel like I kind of missed the whole point. So when I was invited to go talk about my dad, and I know there's a couple people who were at that talk, what I realized was that I wanted to talk about how my dad had lived his life as opposed to what he did. Because the fact of the matter is, as many of you know, I don't like scary things. I love horror fans, but I'm not necessarily a fan of horror. And I love horror fans because we love the same thing. And I also love horror fans because you guys have taught me the importance of having a heart tribe, a community of people that you really connect with. And I was kind of this workaholic loner. So I started giving these talks about my dad, and I remembered what it was that my dad really taught me as a kid. And what he taught me was the importance of joy. Joy, the definition of joy, is the pure and simple delight in being alive. And I think if you see my dad's movies, you can see it in every single thing he did, whether it's listening to the laugh in Thriller, whether it's him playing Egghead on Batman or getting bitten in the neck by Kermit the Frog. My dad had fun. He also knew he had the gift. Life gave him the gift of being able to do what he loved. He was paid to do what he loved, and he understood what a gift that was, so he went out and he encouraged other people to figure out what it was they loved to do and do it, because honestly, if we all showed up and did what we loved, the world would be a vastly different place. And so I changed my life. I decided to figure out how to have more joy in my life. And one of the ways that I found that I had more joy was coming to a convention of people, all of whom love this thing that I don't completely understand. I don't really know why you like going into the dark and getting scared. But what you did was you heard me say that, like, I don't really get why you're horror fans, but you get my dad. And I came into these rooms of horror fans and I felt welcomed. And I felt loved. And I felt like, I said to a friend recently, if I was, you know, bleeding out and somebody put me in front of a church or a horror convention, and I had to choose who were going to be the people who I could trust to help me, it wouldn't even be a choice. I would go to a horror convention any day of the week. I mean, you know, you guys are the most trustworthy, loving, open-hearted, kind people I've ever met. And you gave me the gift of understanding what it is to be, to be able to be surrounded by people who love what you love. And so the thing we have in common is we both love my dad. And so I decided that I would tell you guys really about how my dad lived his life, because honestly, you probably all knew exactly what he was doing in July of 1963 on the set of whatever, way more than I do. So this is the dad who taught me the importance of living a life filled with joy. So I was a daddy's girl, and I show this picture because this was toward the end of my dad's life, and it's at the museum he started in East Los Angeles. He started it with my mom, and they donated first 90 pieces of art, and over their lifetimes, they donated 2,000 pieces of art. It's now an incredible art museum. But the best thing about the art museum is that it's for the kids who go to East Los Angeles College. It's for the community of East Los Angeles. And if any of you have ever been to East LA, there's a big divide between West LA, where the rich white people live, and East LA, where the Latino community, the Hispanic community, the Asian communities are. And there was a big cultural divide between those two communities. And this is a world-class art collection that is accessible to everybody in that community. And so this was an event there, and I begin this because it sort of gives me an opportunity to tell you a little bit about my dad. So, you know, in the movies, my dad was always that very handsome, and he was handsome, beautifully dressed, you know, ascot wearing, smoking jacket wearing, you know, chic man. In real life, he always wore tennis shoes because his feet hurt. He was sort of this preppy kid who went to Yale and he never got over that. He was always wearing a Brooks Brothers shirt, and they were always rumpled. There was a very famous photographer in Hollywood in the 1930s named George Harrell, and if you see all the glamour shots, like, you know, Gary Cooper, all the glamour shots are by George Harrell, and these stars look so gorgeous, and there's one of my dad that George Harrell took, and my dad looks gorgeous up to his neck, and then he's wearing a shirt that looks like he pulled it out of the laundry hamper. Seriously? You know, you're gonna get a photo by George Harrell, you couldn't iron your shirt? So, but he just was so eager to get out and start the next day that he always looked rumpled. And case in point, the ascot, I think that's literally like a bathrobe tie. Like, no, he's that around his neck. But many of you know my dad was a gourmet cook. He was a gourmet cook because he loved to eat. He was 6'4" and he could eat a lot. You can see we tend to run skinny in my family, and people are always amazed at what I can pack away. My dad was the same way. So here we are at this event where they're passing around, you know, little nice appetizers, and my dad has not one but two plastic forks in his pocket. God forbid somebody would, you know, steal one of the plastic, you know, forks, and he'd be like, I can't eat. So, and you know how when you're sharing a meal with someone and you've ordered something really delicious, and you save that last perfect bite for yourself, and you've kind of put it over on the side of the plate, and you're waiting, and then you're gonna have that last perfect bite. And every single time, my dad, with his condor arms, would take his fork, and he'd be like, that looks good, and he'd take the airplane. That was when he was like Vincent Price. That was the true horror of my childhood. It was really the only horror of my childhood. So, I told you that the word that I associate with my dad is joy. And some of you know, I'm actually an interfaith, interspiritual minister. I'm ordained. I've spent a lot of time on my spiritual practice. I write a lot of books about it. But joy to me is the essential spiritual practice. And right now in the world, first of all, I don't think we're being told that. I think we're told to be scared of each other and look for all the problems and the things that are going to divide us. But also, when we're not told that joy is important, we don't understand that that's really what we're put here to do. And that's why I love coming to these conventions, because I walk around and everybody has a smile on their face. You know, you're seeing, like, I mean, I wouldn't collect a monster piece of memorabilia, and believe me, I'm a shopper. But, you know, with a gun to my head, I wouldn't know what to do with it, but put me in a shoe store, I've got that smile on my face. My shoes. And I'm a nomad. I live on the road. Shoes are not a good thing to collect. Like, stickers would be better. But the joy in finding something you love and sharing it with the community that you love it with, it's transformative. We all feel different when we can connect with joy. And my dad, if you look at these pictures, this is my dad at the beginning of his life, and that's the beach house where he lived. He lived in this beach house toward the beginning of his career in Hollywood. And it was an enclave full of artists and sort of celebrities who were very arty, like Fanny Bryce lived next door, and she was a huge art collector. And so there is my dad next to the ocean, one of his favorite things in the world, with that big smile on his face. And there's my dad in Minneapolis at the Walker Art Center, leaning all over a Calder sculpture, filled with joy to be around art. He just had fun in life, and he had fun on the set. So this is, I loved sharing this picture. This was a gag publicity stunt. And here's my dad and three of his dear old friends. We've got Peter Lorre, Basil Rathbone, and Boris Karloff. And of the three, Boris was definitely the closest of his friends. And this was called, you know, lunchtime on the set or something. But you can see how much fun they're having. Peter Lorre's back there slinging in one-liners, and my dad is hamming it up while reading Variety magazine. Boris is laughing so hard that he can hardly eat his sandwich, and so is Basil. And the three of them all became friends in the 1930s. And they became friends when my dad was under contract to Universal, but we'll come to that in a minute. So my dad loved what he would call a convivial set. David Frankham told me that when he was a young actor and he first did his first movie with my dad, he was sitting, David, in his trailer studying his lines, and there came a knock on the door, and my dad said, "What are you doing in here, old boy? Come on out. I like a convivial set." It was always about, you know, people connecting. My dad was never about being better than anyone else, more famous than anyone else. It was about the joy of working together. And Elizabeth, who is here and has worked with him, I'm sure she can tell you a lot about how my dad really, he was different than a lot of other actors. It was about connection, not ego. So how did my dad get to be this joy-filled person? First of all, he grew up in a family of really interesting creative people. He was not the first Vincent Price. He was not the second Vincent Price. The first Vincent Price was Dr. Vincent Clarence Price, and he was a homeopathic physician in the 1800s who couldn't grow a beard. He couldn't grow a mustache and beard, which is hilarious given that my dad was always in a mustache and beard. And so he had a really hard time getting clients. And so he had a lot of free time on his hand, and he lived with his mother, who apparently was the worst cook in the world. And she made these biscuits that you literally could have used as cannonballs. And everybody always had an upset stomach. So he thought, how can I help her cook a little better? We'll all benefit from this. And he invented baking powder. And so he then, like many, this was in the Hudson River Valley in New York. So like many people, he went to with the West. He went to the area near Chicago, and he began knocking on people's doors. He must have had as much charm as my dad, because he knocked on housewives' doors and told them why they needed this new product, baking powder. Then he patented the first extracts of vanilla, breakfast cereals, even dog food. And by the time he died in 1916, he was a household name, had written 4 cookbooks, was a millionaire many times over, and he was called America's housewife's best friend. That was Dr. Vincent Clarence Price. His youngest son was this very artistic guy, and this is a picture of him. This is my grandfather, who was also Vincent Price. And he loved doing magic shows in high school, writing poetry, very creative guy. And I usually share this picture not just because of the cheesy magic act, but because it has a pretty cool connection. So this is Vincent Price's father. And this boy with his head on the plate, his name was Richard Wells, and he would go on to become a doctor, and his son was Orson Welles. Oh. So two of the most famous voices in Hollywood, their fathers were friends in high school. So he went to Yale, my grandfather, but he was pulled out of Yale when the stock market crashed and put in charge of a family business. And by the time his youngest son and namesake, right here, came along, he was very successful. He was the head of the largest candy company in the United States and the head of the National Candy Makers Association. And he had a large, well-to-do family in St. Louis, Missouri. So this little kid who came along later felt very different than his siblings. His siblings were much older. I mean, these are all his siblings. They look like adults, you know, he's a kid. He's this tow-headed kid. They are people who love music and the refined things in life, and he loves art. He fell in love with art. He fell in love with going to the art museum, reading books about art. And so he was a kid in the 1920s in the Midwest, St. Louis, Missouri, who loved art. That made you an oddity. And I think that is very much something my dad brought to all of his characters, because he felt like he didn't fit in. He was, sure, wealthy and well off and had a great education, but to be a Midwestern kid who loved art, you were a little bit of a weirdo. This is his very first play. Fortunately, his parents recognized that he was an odd kid, and they sent him to something called the Community School, which was this sort of arty school. And he was cast as Robin Hood in his very first play. And the interesting thing is, it was his last play for a very long time. He couldn't get cast, and he loved acting. So he would stage manage plays, and he would make home movies. So this is him visiting his grandmother in La Jolla, California, and this is a still shot from one of the home movies he made. Now, my dad very quickly figured out one of the perks of being an actor. The actor always gets the girl. And so many of his home movies were where he was rescuing a damsel in distress, often pulling her out of the waves and, you know, having to give her mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, right? So it was a little, you know, less obvious why he was giving the woman he untied from the railroad tracks mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, but he managed to make it work. And this is, there's no sound to this, but these are some of, it's a composite that actually the Fox Channel in St. Louis gave me of some home movies and a little bit of one of the little mini movies my dad made. This was when he was, I think, at Yale. So handsome guy, as you can see. So this is him, and this is we're dog people. This was one of his dogs, a Scotty, and they had a summer home in Detroit, just across the river from Detroit in Amherstburg, Ontario. Don't know who the hunky guy is. Okay, so this is the whole movie. So here's this beautiful girl, and I love that he fixes her hair before he hugs her. Anyway, she clearly is in distress. I think they're castaways in his tattered clothes. That would be my guess. He staggers off into the dunes, and he comes back with some kindling. And he makes a fake fire, and then he shows her what a hero he is, and they're warming themselves by the fake fire, and of course, then he can hug her. So that is the entire plot of all. But that's what he did when he couldn't get cast in the high school plays. He was a big ham. This is my dad standing in front of the house that his parents built when he was in high school. It's now part of Washington University in St. Louis. And they knew he was such an arty kid that they gave him the attic, essentially, except they called it the garret. He could have the garret. So he set up his whole artist studio in the garret, and that's him in a beaver coat and bowler hat in the 1920s. You know, this was not your average Midwestern kid. He, like his father, went to Yale, and he thought, I'm going to get a fresh start. I'm going to audition for things. Still, never got cast. And so he joined the Glee Club and he toured the world singing with the Glee Club. He joined the Elizabethan Club, so he got to do Shakespeare. He wrote poetry, he studied art history. And when he was a senior at Yale, he met the most famous person he'd ever met, the great cartoonist and essayist James Thurber. And this was James Thurber's 22nd birthday gift to my dad, 1933. So that's James Thurber, that's his wife, envious age is James Thurber. They met because they both had dachshunds. Again, we're a dog family. So that's the dachshund loyalty. I think it's very interesting that he was so prescient, James Thurber, that up there is Hitler looming right over Yale, Harvard, and a lot of references to booze because this was during Prohibition, and there's my dad, youth. And I think it's really interesting that he's got fear looking over his shoulder. So my dad said to James Thurber, you know, more than anything, I want to become an actor. I love art and I love art history, but I'm not good enough to be an artist. I want to be an actor. And Thurber laughed at him. He was like, are you kidding me? You didn't get cast in high school. You couldn't get cast at Yale. What are you going to, like, go to New York or go to Hollywood and just become a star? You love art. Do what you love. So my dad went to study art history at the University of London. And that is how my dad ended up in London. Now, what I'm going to tell you is my dad had the last laugh. James Thurber wrote an essay in 1944 for The New Yorker, and it was called How to Give Young People Advice. And in it he wrote, ever since I told Vincent Price not to become an actor, I never give young people advice. So this is my dad, the aesthete in London, and he lived literally on Baker Street. He studied art history, but every spare minute he went to see the theater. He saw John Gielgud's famous production of Hamlet like 8 times. And his roommates were like, seriously, dude, if you love this so much, why don't you just audition for something? So there was this private theater. They were doing a production of an American play, very risque, had been banned in the United States, called Chicago. And my dad auditioned for it. He got the part of a gum-chewing cop. He actually said, I got the part because I could walk and chew gum at the same time. Not a lot of people were chewing gum in Britain at that point. So the next play that was going to be there was a play called Victoria Regina. It was a big deal because unlike now where you can have The Crown on TV while Queen Elizabeth is still alive, in those days 50 years had to pass between the death of a monarch before you could display them on the public stage. But this was a private theater club and the playwright was a very well-known playwright, so there was a lot of buzz around it. And my dad was pretty convinced that he could get the part of Prince Albert. He was tall like Prince Albert, he was fair-haired like Prince Albert, and the art history he was studying was German art history, so he spoke German. He auditioned for the part and he got it. And he just took off. He had headshots taken. This is a funny story. So in his headshots, the guy said, you know, well, I know you're a starving actor. How about this? I'll take them for free for you if you give me a couple for my portfolio. Well, 2 weeks later, my dad was walking through Piccadilly Circus, and there was this photograph advertising deodorant soap like 3 times. He could have asked. So he didn't do that again. Long story short, this is my dad's entrance into Stark. And it was such a big hit that he was named Best Newcomer of the Year of the British stage, Male Newcomer of the Year. And the Female Newcomer of the Year that year also did very well for herself. Her name was Vivian Leigh. So an American producer came over. He bought it as a vehicle for his leading lady, the first lady of the American theater, Helen Hayes. And my dad was sent along with it because the playwright refused to sell the rights unless he took my dad, the producer. And that's how he ended up on Broadway in the biggest hit show. So all of a sudden, my dad is the next big thing. He is a matinee idol. There was a scene where he shows, it's apparently in 1936, this scene where my dad shows Queen Victoria how a man shaves was like the most intimate romantic scene. Women were like swooning at the stage door for him. So Hollywood comes calling, and he's offered a $1 million movie contract in 1935, still the Depression, $1 million. And my dad This is telling you a lot about my dad. He went to Helen Hayes and he asked for her advice. And she asked him a question. Do you think you know your craft? And my dad thought about that. And he thought, well, how would I? I've been in like 1.5 plays, this and Robin Hood, essentially, you know? She said, precisely. If you want to have a long career and not just be a flash in the pan in the movies, you learn your craft. So my dad played on Broadway for 2 years in this play, and every summer Broadway would close, no air conditioning in those days. And so he did all these summer stock plays with some of the greatest leading ladies out there. And so when Hollywood came calling again, this is my dad in a production of Turandot with the great Chinese-American actress Anna May Wong, who now I am super happy to say has a coin. There's an Anna May Wong quarter. So when my dad was offered the movie contract again, he took it, and he went out to Hollywood really eager to be an actor. But they saw this handsome man, and they thought, he's going to be perfect in romantic comedies. So his first movie was a screwball comedy. Never once did I hear my dad say a good thing about it.
Oh.
And when I finally saw it, it actually was so perfectly, you know, decent screwball comedy. But my dad said, that's not the kind of actor I want to be. I love actors like Spencer Tracy and Jimmy Cagney and Edward G. Robinson. I want to be a character actor. I don't want to be some fluffy, you know, romantic lead. And so Hollywood really didn't know what to do with him. So he went back to the theater and he joined Orson Welles' Mercury Theater. Orson Welles was like doing these cutting edge avant-garde productions. And my dad was in this troupe of players. One of the people in the troupe of players was an actress named Edith Barrett, and he married her. But other people like Norman Lloyd, Joseph Cotten, and they were these young buck actors who really were serious about the theater. So my dad in Hollywood kept trying to find his place. He was in some good films. He was in The Private Lives of Elizabeth and Essex with Errol Flynn and Bette Davis. He was in Tower of London, and that's how he met Basil and Boris. My dad had a scene where he was killed. He was drowned in a big vat of wine, and Boris and Basil played this little prank on him. They told everybody, the crew, the cast, to dump their cigarette butts and coffee grounds in this vat of wine, and then they held him down a little too long, and my dad came up spluttering with cigarette butts all over him, laughing. And they were like, this guy's going to be okay. And then he was in a film that he took great glee in because he said, how many actors can say they've been in one of the worst movies ever made? I mean, really, it's horrendous, this movie. It should have been good. It was James Whale, you know, and it should have been great. It had a really good cast. It is like the screenwriter should be shot. It was so racist and so bad. But long story short, you know, he really couldn't get his groove. So in 1940, Edith gave birth to my dad's first child, Vincent Barrett Price, in Hollywood. But my dad quickly went back to the theater. And he did a play on Broadway called Angel Street. And it is still the longest running melodrama on Broadway. And my dad played a character named Mr. Manningham. And this play invented the term gaslight. And basically he tries to, this would be a theme for my dad, get rid of his wife. He had tried to get rid of a lot of wives in his movies, a few in real life too. And so here he is, this beautifully spoken, you know, smoking jacket wearing handsome man. And that was the turning point, because when he felt the audience hate him, he thought, this is how I can be a character actor. I can be 6'4" and beautifully spoken and, you know, educated and articulate. I can be a gothic villain. And that was the start of it. So he went back to Hollywood. He was under contract with 20th Century Fox, and he started getting more of those kinds of roles. And that's when you start seeing the Vincent Price we all know. This is my dad as, whoops, let's go back, the evil inspector, sorry. Back, the evil Inspector Dutour in The Song of Bernadette. And it's a really, if you haven't seen that movie, it's a beautiful arc of a character in that movie. But you can see, you know, that's the Vincent Price we're starting to know. In Laura, not so much, but for him, again, one of the things that was so important to my dad was being in ensemble movies. And this, if you haven't seen Laura, it's my favorite of my dad's films, and it's a fantastic film noir. And then this was really the movie that changed everything. He wanted this part more than anything in Dragon Wick. And he lost 60 pounds to get the part. It was one of three films he was in opposite Gene Tierney. And I saw this movie for the first time when I was an exchange student in Germany. And I was just in France 3 weeks ago. And the place I was staying was surrounded by oleander bushes. Do you know what those look like? They grow in sort of warm climates. And they grew all over when I was growing up. So when I was a little kid, you know, my dad wasn't one of those nervous parents, like, don't touch that, don't do that. But if I ever, and we had oleander bushes all over the house where I grew up, and every time I'd walk by one, he'd say, don't eat the bush. And I'm like, I'm not gonna eat the bush. And you know, he didn't say this when I walked by the daisies or the rose bushes. Like, you know, well, I found out when I finally saw this movie as an exchange student in Germany why my dad was so anxious about oleander, not to give the plot away. He tries to kill two wives in this movie. See, theme here. Making a cake with frosting with oleander flowers. Turns out they're very poisonous, and it scarred my dad for life. He was just completely paranoid that his child would die. That was going to be his karma from eating oleander flowers. Oh. Anyway, that movie was really the big change for him, because that was the point where he carried a whole film as a leading man playing a gothic villain. And I include this shot from it because those of you who are movie fans might recognize this character actress. She plays an Irish maid. It's Jessica Tandy in an early role. So we got Laura. I don't know why we're... There we go. We've got films like The Bribe, you know, where he's doing a lot of film noir movies. And I don't know why we have Ava Gardner in here. So long story short, the middle of the 40s, three things happen. One, his contract with Fox runs out. Two, his parents both die. And three, he goes through a hideous, ugly divorce chronicled by Hedda Hopper and Luella Parsons. And he's left alone with his dog, Joe. Well, the good news is that handsome movie stars don't stay single for long, as you still see in the tabloids. And this is his wedding picture to his second wife. He met a costume designer on a movie called Up in Central Park. They fell in love, and they liked to go to Tijuana, where they would have Caesar salad at the famous Caesar's restaurant, drink a little too much tequila, and they liked to take their friends down there. So this gentleman was the head of the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, and they took him down to Tijuana, and he said, "You guys are such a great couple. You should get married." This is their wedding picture. So we got honeymoon trip. I bet my mother was thrilled. She happened to have a white dress with her. This is my dad on my ass. That is literally his wedding picture. And this is the ass who was their best man who suggested they get married. However, it was a marriage that lasted 23 years. So they were very well suited to each other. And they had the same interests. And that is a recipe for joy. They both love dogs. There's Joe again, so not to be outdone, my mother got a matching cat. She got a tortoiseshell cat to go with the tortoiseshell dog and named the cat Josephine, of course, right? They both loved the arts and design. They were both sort of cutting edge, avant-garde people. They loved to travel. My mother grew up all over the world. She was British, but grew up in Shanghai, China. She grew up in British Columbia. And so when they traveled, it wasn't bucket list travel. It was about learning about a culture through its art, through its food, through its people. And so she really, you can see, they get it. They just found, he found that person who he could have that joy with. So we move into the 1950s, and things are going well. He's under contract to Howard Hughes for RKO. He makes His Kind of Woman, I think a film that a lot of you know and love, Las Vegas Story. And He's happily married, things are going really well, and then everything falls apart. Not just in my dad's life, but for many of his peers and in this country. We go through a very ugly period called the McCarthy era, the Red Scare, where many of my dad's peers were accused of being communists. Many had to flee the country. They lost their life savings. They took their own lives. My dad was not blacklisted, but he was graylisted. He was put on a list where he was accused of being a communist. And this is the logic of that list. The list was called the pre-war anti-Nazi sympathizers. They said that if you were against Hitler before we declared war on Germany, then you must have been a communist. Well, Eleanor Roosevelt was on the list too, so he was in very good company. But the bottom line is, my dad did not work for over a year. He wrote a book during that time. He tried to keep himself busy. And when he finally got his name cleared, he was offered two parts. Now, I've told you my dad often went back to the theater to kind of find himself. He was offered a part on Broadway, but he didn't take that part. He took a movie. And he took a movie because it was done in this new technology. And even though my dad barely could figure out how to turn on a radio, he knew that Hollywood was driven by technology. And the movie was a little movie called House of Wax. Now, House of Wax changed his life. And if you think about the horror career of Vincent Price, it starts right here in 1952, 53 with House of Wax. And the arc of it goes about 20 years through Theater of Blood. Now, House of Wax did some amazing things for my dad. He was very modest about it. He always said the reason it was so successful was because it wasn't one of those gimmicky, 3D movies. You know, it was because of the director. And the reason the director didn't use a lot of gimmicks in the movie is because the director had one eye.
Whoa.
And if you only have one eye, you literally cannot see in 3D. It requires two eyes. So he didn't make a gimmicky movie. He told a good story. That's what my dad said. But I have a different theory. My theory is my dad's passion was the arts. His passion was the visual arts. And he plays a sculptor whose life work is destroyed by greed. And he goes mad and he exacts the revenge. I think it was a metaphor for everything that had happened to him and his friends through the McCarthy era. But I also feel like it created the quintessential Vincent Price character. Because think about House of Wax, right? Okay, he's killing women. He's hanging people in elevator shafts. He's stealing bodies out of the morgue. He's dipping them in wax. And we're all rooting for him, right? We are all rooting for Vincent Price, right? And that is the quintessential Vincent Price character. There's so many characters where you think, this guy's not exactly a good guy. But he said he played men besieged by fate, somebody who something happens to them and they exact the revenge, often from a state of a kind of madness, lovesick madness or artistic madness. And that really is why I think it created the quintessential Vincent Price character. Now, my dad had no idea this movie would go through the roof. A year later, it was playing in, first run movie houses. Nothing does that. Well, now no movie lasts more than 2 weeks in a movie house, but even like Avatar didn't run for a year. So a year later, my dad's on Broadway in Richard III, and he's still seeing Vincent Price in House of Wax at a Times Square movie theater. So he's like, there can't be anyone in there still seeing this movie. So he goes in, it's packed with kids. And he's like, that's it. This is my new audience. It's a new generation. And that became his new audience, winning over new generations. And he loved that. To the end of his life, he said, I don't want to be one of those old, boring adults. I want to know what kids like. I want to know what young people want. If we know what young people want, then the world is going to stay fresh and alive. And so anyway, he's sitting there. He sits himself behind these two teenage girls, right? And they're like terrified, right? And he's watching as they're like freaking out over the House of Wax. And at the very end, as the credits rolled, that's when the little devil and angel popped up on my desk. And he leans forward and he says to the girls, did you like it? Those two poor girls, I like to think they needed a lot of therapy. So that's my dad and mom at the premiere. So the 50s are a really beautiful era for my dad. My parents were, as we said, animal lovers. Talk about joy. Nothing brings you more joy than your animals. So there's Joe, who now has Prudence and Pasquale. All of our dogs had to begin with P. So, and then my mom bred poodles, so there were a lot of P's. And my mom didn't want Joe to feel left out, so he became Pajoe. And they collected art, and they opened their house to students all over Los Angeles. And he got to pair up with an amazing director who was a perfect fit for introducing him to yet even younger, cooler audiences, and that was William Castle, the great showman. And this is, you know, maybe the quintessential Vincent Price character, right? Frederick Lauren. Because think about it, at the beginning of the movie, you're not really sure, like, is this guy just like some kind of, you know, sadist? Is he like, what is his deal? Is he this misogynistic? Like, who is this guy? And then as the film turns, you know, even though he's not doing the best things, you are rooting for him. You want that wife to get her just rewards, right? So, you know, these films were so much fun because they were, people were offered million dollar insurance policies to go in and see it. They rigged the seats with shocks so people would scream. They swung skeletons through the audience. I mean, imagine being a kid and getting to go see all of that. It would have been my worst nightmare, but anyway. So we get into the early 1960s, and he's offered a 3-movie deal in Rome. And so they decide to go live in Rome for 9 months. His favorite city, so much art. And they decide to take this little trip up to Paris to see their dear friend Diana Durbin and eat all the fantastic French food. Problem is, when they get there, Mary, his wife, only wants Chinese food. I was the reason for the Chinese food. Complete surprise. So, yeah, that's me, the pudgy baby. So he's 1 month shy of his 51st birthday, and she was 45, and I was their first child. So, yeah, can you say surprise? But, you know, he was always away at the beginning. He lectured 60 cities in 65 days every year for 30 years on the visual arts, went all over talking about the arts. He was making all the Poe movies with Roger Corman, and that was a huge thing. One of the things that brought him the greatest joy was an alliance. I keep talking about connections and how working together. He believed that Edgar Allan Poe was the American artist, writer, creator, who changed the tide of how America was viewed by the rest of the world. So prior to Poe, everything was about what are the Europeans doing? Everything was about this is, you know, we're this new country and they are the experts. But Poe changed all of that, because after Poe, Europeans began looking at us differently. And Poe was that person. So for my dad to forever be associated with Edgar Allan Poe through these movies, through all the readings, through the performances that he did, it was a profound connection. And talk about joy. Working on Poe was great joy for him. But this was the dad I knew. You know, I was a little kid when he was making those movies. So the dad that I knew, we bought this, I was telling you about it. That's the Clark Cortez. So he came home one day with this sort of beige milk truck, and my mother was like, what the heck? And he said, it's gonna be so much fun, because he was on something called the Indian Arts and Crafts Board of the Department of the Interior, traveling to reservations all over the country, making sure that Native American artists were promoted and not exploited. So we went all over the West, and he would, you know, make this delicious food, and we'd cook it in the kitchen, and we'd, you know, stay in the RV, and that's me standing in the back of the RV with him. That's the dad I knew. And he, you know, it was so much fun. We'd pass someplace, you know, I grew up in Hollywood, right? And he's like, A&W root beer, you haven't had that. he's like, okay, there's no speed limit here. You want to see what 100 miles an hour feels like? Imagine what 100 miles an hour feels like in that, right? And my mother's like, I can see, she was just terrified. And I'm like, yeah. So that was the dad that I grew up with. He also loved to cook. Now, my mother was the baker, in all fairness, and everything was an excuse to bake a cake. We got a pug. There's the pug cake, right? But food was a huge part of our life. And food, you know, people say now, foodies, foodies, foodies. And there's this idea of like, you're eating at the best place or you're eating a certain kind of food. For my dad, food was about connection. And there's this great quote by the incredible French chef named Paul Bocuse that if food is not cooked with the intention of bringing joy to a friend, don't bother cooking. And that was my dad. Food was about connecting. You made something so you could share the experience of eating it. And I was and am still a finicky eater. I think both my parents are like, how did we get her? But still, he would find ways to make things for me that brought us together as a family. The other part of the dad that I knew at that time was he was doing this cool project for Sears Roebuck. Sears was the biggest department store in the world. They were changing their image. They hired all these spokespeople, like Sir Edmund Hillary had just climbed Mount Everest, so he was like camping gear. And so they approached my dad, who was by this point as famous as an art expert as he was as an actor, and they said, can you rep our Sears art collection? And my dad went and looked at the art at Sears, and he was like, no. But my mother, who was always years ahead of her time, said, this is Sears Roebuck, the biggest department store in the world. If you could do anything for them, what would you do? He said, well, if they'd let me buy the art. She said, why don't you suggest that? That's what happened. My dad bought art for Sears, Picasso's, Whistler's, Vuillard's, Dalí's, emerging artists. This is our living room. This is the inventory list. This is it all over the floor. And my mother framed them all in our basement. So it was a family affair, and the joy, here was the thing. My dad felt like art should not be something that the average person had to go to a museum to see. For him to live with a piece of art brought him joy, and he felt that everyone should have that opportunity. So you could buy a Picasso on your Sears credit card for under $100 with a money back guarantee. Pretty unbelievable. So talk about joy. And from that came cooking. As I said, they love to cook. Well, an executive at Sears said, you're always making meals for your friend. My mother was always bringing back design elements and menus. And so they wrote a cookbook. And that cookbook, became a huge bestseller. 1965, 365,000 copies they sold of this cookbook. It was the first beautiful coffee table cookbook. And it became so famous and so beloved that Saveur magazine named it one of the 100 most important culinary events of the 20th century. It was a big deal. So that was my parents' marriage. And I say was because this is the last trip that we all took together. I always try to find the silver lining, and the silver lining in the end of their marriage was that it was right around the end of the period where people wore clothes that looked like the drapes. What were we thinking? Look, my dad is wearing a seersucker jacket. It's around the 4th of July. He looks like a normal human being. My mother and I are wearing like a sofa. So thank God that ended at the same time as their marriage. But it was always for my dad about sharing the experience. Travel was, and that's why I still try to travel whenever I can. If you can't learn about another culture, if you see people over there or over here as being different, how are we ever going to come together as a world? So this, I showed you the picture of their wedding at the beginning. This is my parents at the end of their marriage. I took this picture. I then as now love to photograph. These are two people looking at the same thing. And there is my dad, that same joy. And there is my mother, not looking so happy. Everyone says that fame and celebrity and being an influencer and being out there in the world is the most important thing. The fact of the matter is most of us aren't cut out for it. I'm somebody who happened to have been given front of house skills. I'm happy as a clam chatting with all of you. But unlike my dad, at the end of chatting with all of you, I need to go back and be quiet and walk my dog and be on my own. My mother was even more introverted than me. She wouldn't have been stood up here if you'd promised her $1 million and a mansion. She was somebody, her job was to make people, she was a costume designer and an architectural designer. Her job was to make other people's lives who were in the front more presentable. But being Mrs. Vincent Price with somebody who was that full of life and wanted to be out there, it was tough for her. So when they got a divorce, I want to give the happy ending, my mother became a very successful architectural designer and went on to live an incredibly creative life, and they remained best friends. The divorce part wasn't that pretty, though, because my dad was doing a film called Theater of Blood, and one of the actresses in the movie took a fancy to my dad, and she told the leading lady being Diana Rigg, that she'd sort of taken a fancy to my dad. And poor Diana Rigg had no idea my dad was married, and she set them up on a date. She apologized to me, Diana Rigg, but it wasn't her fault. She didn't know. Long story short, the divorce part wasn't that pretty, but the ending was a happy one. And so this is how my future stepmother met her end. About 10 years ago, I was giving this talk, and I heard the words come out of my mouth, "Sometimes I wish he'd done it in real life." I was like, whoa, well, those words back in. But the fact of the matter is, some people are kind of out to be parents or step-parents, and some people aren't. And my stepmother was not one of those people. She referred to herself as my wicked stepmother. That's never good. But the other part of my stepmother was, she was like Auntie Mame meets Cruella de Vil. You know, I would not trade the experience of having had her as my stepmother ever, because she was so full of life. And she was somebody who could match my dad in that joy of being out there in the world. So as I like to say, if I got this dad back, the dad who had his partner in being out there in the world and full of joy, then I could endure the arched eyebrow of Coral Brown from time to time. They were a really good couple. And as a kid, you know, watching that, I always wanted what was best for my dad, even if she was challenging. The other thing that Coral did for him, so the arc of his career, we go from, in the horror movies, House of Wax to Theater of Blood, and then, as you all know much better than I do, horror movies change, right? We start getting slasher movies, we start seeing the throats cut, and my dad didn't like that. My dad always said that what we can imagine in our minds is way scarier or way sexier than anything anyone sees on screen. Think about, because if you don't see it, you all of a sudden picture yourself in that position. And it's a whole different thing. And now I think we've come around where, you know, psychological thrillers, you don't always see it, but you're living it. But my dad did not find his niche in those movies because he really didn't want to. And so my stepmother found him this play. It was Oscar Wilde at the end of his life. And he did it as a one-man show for 6 years on Broadway, in London, in Australia, all over the world. And honestly, it was the best thing I'd ever seen him do. And I will tell this one story because I find it really moving. It came out in 1978, and that was the same summer. It opened in San Francisco. It was the same summer that Anita Bryant, who probably most people don't even remember who she was, she was a singer, and she pitched orange juice on the television. She came out screaming against homosexuality, and she was on this rage against homosexuality. So here's Vincent Price, every talk show host's favorite guest, playing Oscar Wilde, then the most famous gay man in the world. And so they would say, Johnny Carson or whomever, "So, Mr. Price, you're playing Oscar Wilde. What do you think of what Miss Bryant is saying about homosexuality?" And this was my dad's answer, ever classy. "Miss Bryant, yes, I think Oscar Wilde wrote a play about her. A woman of no importance." So, do we remember Anita Bryant? No. Do we remember Vincent Price and Oscar Wilde? Yes.
Yeah.
So, as the sort of horror scene changed, what he found was the people who were the monster kids wanted to do work with the great horror actors. So even sometimes, you know, the films weren't that great, but this was House of the Long Shadows, where Chris and Peter and John Carradine and my dad got to work together. And for those of you who don't know, it's really kind of cool. So Peter Cushing's birthday is May 26th, and Vincent's and Peter's is May 27th. They all share the same birthday. And you know, if you say there's no type for a horror actor, you're wrong. Look at all of them with these long, thin faces and you know, and each of them, lovely human beings. He does a cooking show in London, which we just signed a contract with the British Film Institute. It's everybody's asked, when is it ever going to be released? It's going to be finally be released. So it'll be beautiful, literally blasphemy. It's super neat. And for those of you who've been to my table and seen the cookbook Cooking Price Wise, that goes with this show. And it's hilarious. The cheapest set you've ever seen in your life. Like at one point, he's teaching how to make an American turkey, and there's literally no place to put the turkey. He has to put it on the ground. So
that's cool.
And he lectures, as I said, about the arts. And here was the thing about the lecturing. As I told you about the joy, my dad felt that if each of us really think about this, try to take this in, if our society valued people getting paid to do what they love, if each of us did what we loved with our lives, imagine how we would feel every day, and imagine how different it would be. And I know it seems like pie in the sky, but it's not. You know, I like you, you know, I know everybody thinks, you know, movie star kid, you know, I had a silver spoon in my mouth. I'm still working. I work 7 days a week. I still earn the money that pays my bills. I'm not a trust fund kid. That's not something my parents believed in. It took me a long time to realize I need to show up and do what I love. And that's part of why I come to these conventions, because I get to talk about someone I love and about something that I think matters with people who get it. So that's what he did. He would talk to colleges and students about pursuing their dreams. And then we have something wonderful happen. So my dad was doing a TV show, and it was called Read, Write, and Draw for Disney, and it was about teaching young kids how to tell stories. And he would go to Disney to film this, and somebody comes up to him and says, you know, there's this young animator, and he's this huge fan of yours, you know, would you go meet him? Of course. You know, my dad never said no to a fan, never said no to an autograph. He could have been like in the ambulance on the way to the ER, he would have signed an autograph. I kid you not. I once was sitting in a restaurant with him, and the line went out the door of the restaurant, past the windows to the restaurant, down the block, and he sat there for an hour while the food got cold signing autographs and was happy to do it. That was who he was. So he goes down to meet this, you know, animator with some spiky hair who's written this little film about a boy named Vincent Molloy who wants to grow up to be Vincent Price, and my dad agrees to narrate it for Tim Burton, and that changed the arc of Tim's career. And then Tim gives it back to my dad. He gives my dad the perfect swan song. It's not just the perfect swan song because it introduces him to a whole new generation of kids once again, but it's the perfect swan song because it captures everything about my dad that I think everybody always felt. The sweetness, the fatherliness, the person you wanted to hope Vincent Price was, even as he was scaring the pants off of you. And it was just the perfect arc for my dad. So this is something my dad said. I've come to believe that remembering someone is not the highest compliment. It is missing them. And I used to have this in my show, my, you know, slideshow. And then one day I thought, that's not true. The highest compliment you can give to someone you miss and you loved is living their legacy forward. And that's when I realized every single one of us had someone in our lives that shared something they loved with us. Maybe it was a grandmother who was an amazing cook and she showed us how to make her lasagna, or, you know, changing out, you know, the oil in your dad's car, or going fishing or playing catch. My dad and I played catch. He was a big baseball fan. I'm still a big baseball fan. Every day that he was home and waited for the school bus, we played catch in the driveway. You know, it doesn't have to be a big deal, but that love is what lasts. We remember those people because love sticks. You know, what's really interesting is that we as humans, the human brain is programmed to Velcro fear and Teflon the good. Where we often forget the good things in our life and we hold on to the things that scare us. That's why horror films do so well. But what transcends that is the love that someone has given us. And I realized the only way I could really share what mattered about my dad was sharing his legacy. because literally that is the thing that I have. People say, do you have anything of your dad's? I say, I don't need anything of my dad's. I've got him. I've got the thing that everybody wants of my dad. What was he like? And when I say how wonderful he was, everyone looks at me like, thank goodness, because that's what I thought. But if he had said the opposite, I would have been really bummed. So that is why I do what I do. And so I want to leave you with a couple of things that my dad taught me. The first is that he always said, if you're always curious, you'll never be bored. My dad was a lifelong learner. And so I remember one time when I was a kid, he said, I've heard the best taquito. Do you guys know what a taquito is? It's like a rolled tortilla, corn tortilla stuffed with meat, and they dunk it in a deep fryer, and then you dip it in hot sauce and guacamole, and now I'm really hungry. So he said, the best taquito is at this car wash. We're going to go down and taste it. So we go down to this car wash because there's little stands by the car washes in those days. And we had this taquito. And of course, my dad, being the most personable person on the planet, is chatting with everyone. And somebody says, you think this is good? Oh, go to Pedro's, you know, down there. So the whole day we went around eating taquitos in Los Angeles. But we didn't just eat taquitos. We went into little shops that sold cool things, and we went into neighborhoods where we saw murals. I remember that day, and I will remember it for the rest of my life, because this little curiosity about what is the best taquito in Los Angeles led to a day of adventure. If you are always curious, you'll never be bored. And I tell you what, I was alone in a town where I knew no one during the pandemic, because I'm a nomad. I stopped and I didn't see one single person. I knew no one for 10 months, maybe longer. And I was never bored because he was always with me. I found out everything about that area because I was never bored. He also said, if you limit your interests, you'll limit your life. You know, in school, they always told us, find the thing you're good at. We're not good at one thing. We're not just interested in one thing. We love many things. So don't limit your interests. You know, you guys know that. That's why I love coming here. You know, whatever it is you do for your living, or, you know, how you raise your kids, you're all here because you love monster movies and you're monster kids. You know, if you're constantly thinking there's one thing I'm supposed to be doing, that's not how life works. And the last thing he said to me was, always say yes. And so this is the thing I'm going to leave you with, because this to me is the key to a life well lived. The things that you love my dad in, William Castle came up to my dad sitting at a table eating a piece of pie, pissed off that he didn't get a part that he tried out for. And William Castle sits down and pitches him this thing that's going to have skeletons and buzzers into seats and some, you know, weird movie about a guy who wants to, you know, hire, you know, give people money to go to a haunted house. And what did my dad say? Yes. My dad gets a call from Quincy Jones. Quincy Jones' wife is Peggy Lipton. My dad was on a Mod Squad episode with Peggy Lipton. They became best friends. And he says, well, you know, there's this young guy. He was, you know, a singer in a group, but now he's doing a solo album, and he really would like you to do this thing called a rap. Would you do it? My dad didn't have to hear anymore. Yes, he said, and that became Thriller. Same thing with Tim Burton, what I just told you. My dad said yes. When The Muppet Show came out, people were like, puppets on primetime? Are you crazy? You can't imagine the number of famous people who said no the first year. The second year, everybody wanted to be on The Muppet Show. But guess who said yes? Vincent Price. You know, if I said to you guys, do you want to go have lunch? And you're like, well, it's Sunday, we got a long drive home, and, you know, there's like 12 other things I want to see, you know. If you don't say yes, we're never going to have lunch, you know. If you don't say yes, if you don't risk saying yes, you don't know what the next thing life is going to offer you. And joy and the legacy of love is why you guys are all here. That's why I'm here with you guys, because you all know I don't like the scary stuff. And if we can take what we feel in this room and bring it out of the world is going to be a better place. I'm going to end by telling you a tiny little thing that I'm launching. I'm launching a new website, sort of a soft launch, and I decided to call it Oddity. Oddity, and then the tagline is different together, because that's what you guys all taught me. We don't have to have a checklist of things in common. What we have to do is love each other's differences and love learning about each other's differences and realize that if, like we all do in this room, we can be different together, that's what's going to save the world. You guys are my model for what's going to save the world. So let's take that out. That's what I learned from my dad. That's what I learned from you. Please, let's take that out into the world and let's be different together. Thanks, you guys.
For listening to this episode of Monster Kid Radio. I appreciate everybody here for downloading the show, listening to the show, rating the show, and most importantly, sharing the show. Please talk about Monster Kid Radio on your preferred social media platforms, whether it's on Facebook, X, Reddit, Patreon, Instagram, Discord, wherever it is you hang out online. Let people know about Monster Kid Radio, because the more listeners we have, the more downloads we have, the more Monster Kids we have, the better. You know, it just helps to grow the show and grow the audience. And I actually had an idea for a series of future episodes earlier today, but it's only going to work if I can get some new voices into the mix, or, you know, some of the old favorites as well. I love all the Monster Kid Radio regulars. I'm only kidding. I don't know what I'm talking about. Anyway, moving on. Thank you for listening to the show. I really appreciate it. Now, if you want to know anything about Monster Kid Radio, head over to monsterkidradio.net. That's where you're going to find everything you need to know about the podcast. We've got links to all of those social media channels, our contact information, which I'll have Beth go over again here in a second.
Have something you'd like to share with Monster Kid Radio? You can email the podcast at monsterkidradio@gmail.com, or you can call and leave a voicemail at 360-524-2484.
And links to other things like Monster Bash and things like that. Beth and I are committed to getting back to Monster Bash. I cannot wait to get back to Monster Bash. But in the meantime, I am eternally grateful for all the people who go to Monster Bash and then send us recordings and content from the convention. Scott and Tracy Morris, once again, thank you for the Victoria Price recording. It means a lot to have that coming in. And I know I've got other listeners who have said they're going to send other material in as well. And as soon as we get it, we're going to play it. In fact, if I get it by next week, that's what we're going to play on the show next week. Stay tuned. I'll mention on Monster Kid Radio, or at least on Facebook and X, what we're doing as soon as I get that figured out. Things are kind of in flux right now because, as we mentioned last week, Beth and I are moving to Arizona, the Phoenix area. And Beth is actually down in Phoenix already. She has taken a teaching job at a private school, and she is laying the groundwork for Monster Kid Radio and Team Death down in Phoenix. That's not true. She's actually just starting her job. She's going to be flying back up here right around Labor Day to help me finish packing. Yeah, she left me here to do all the packing. And while I do poke fun at her for leaving me to do all of the packing, I totally understand. But she's going to fly back up, and then she's going to fly back down with Wednesday. And then about a week later, I'm going to be going down myself. I am hoping that I am able to stay in the Pacific Northwest long enough to be a panelist at Rose City Comic Con. I've been asked to be on two panels at Rose City Comic Con. Rose City Comic Con is happening in Portland, Oregon, September 6th, 7th, and 8th. And the two panels that I've been asked to be on, one is moderated by a friend of the show, David Heath, and it's going to be about Lovecraft gods. That'll be a lot of fun. And then the other panel, oh man, this one's going to be fun too. Jessica Dwyer is moderating a panel. It has to do with how monster movie monsters were treated in the 1970s. So things like Blackula and the Night Stalker and some of my fellow panelists. I don't know if it's been publicly announced yet, so I'm hesitant to say, but trust me when I tell you, me sitting at the same table during a panel like this, I mean, not to reveal my Generation X-ness too much, but we're not worthy. We're not worthy in my best Wayne's World impersonation. That was terrible impersonation. But man, it's going to be a good time. And then shortly after that, I'll be heading down to Arizona, where hopefully I'll have a job lined up and we'll figure out what our next steps are. There are a lot of monster movie and horror things that we're looking forward to getting involved with down in Arizona, as well as up here before I leave. So if you are local to the area, I would love to connect with you one more time before I head down as well.
Monster Kid Radio is a Team Death production. All original content of Monster Kid Radio is licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution, Non-Commercial, No Derivatives 4.0 Unported license. You can learn more about Team Death or other projects like Death Designs, Mail Order Zombie, Monster Kid Writer, and more at www.teamdeath.com. Remember, death is spelled D-E-T-H. That's teamdeath.com. Please rate and review Monster Kid Radio wherever you download your favorite podcasts.
Catacomber is copyright 2024. The Ouija Chords. It appears on their album, Rotten Roll with the Ouija Chords. You can find them at theouijachords.bandcamp.com and pick up their album. It is a digital release for $5. It's totally worth it. Check it out. Let them know that Monster Kid Radio sent you. Of course, there's a link in the show notes to make that super easy for you. My name is Derek M. Cook. I'll talk to everybody next week. Ciao.